coming from Institute for Plasma Research, and I'll speak about ITER, International Thermonuclear Experimental Reactor, a reactor which is going to be built in the south of France, is supposed to make show the largest fusion power till date. So let's start the presentation with a tiny video of what ITER is. So you see in the screen, so what you see here is this video takes you to the south of France, where the ITER machine, the largest fusion reactor on the world, is going to be built, and you are going to see parts of the construction going on there. And this video is taken with a drone, and yeah, that's the construction site of ITER. Audio is not coming?
No, this way.
That's not, there is no video, audio, yeah. So you see parts of the machine being built, large rooms and basements and stuff like that. We will see why this is needed and how this is going to contribute to our quest for generating energy from fusion. So you see gigantic cranes, large bits of roughly 20-story building, and huge vessels made of stainless steel. And this is a 400 kV electric substation, only for ITER, for powering the fusion reactor. So we'll see why we need it in a short while. ITER organization is the organization which manages the building of ITER, and the site that you see right now is about 180 hectares of land. So the whole construction is going to be carried out there. And now we ask the question, why do we want to build such a reactor, and why do we want to build such a huge reactor? That brings us back to the question, why do we want to have fusion after all? Because we want energy. You heard in the previous talk that our energy resources are going down year by year. And if we look at the quality of life, which means, for example, the life expectancy, how long one lives on average, life expectancy in countries, this is very closely related to how much energy do you consume. So if you look at the energy per capita energy consumption, that is, if you take the energy of the whole world divided by the number of people in the world, then we see that this is roughly one-third of the world average in India. That means our quality of life is somehow related to one-third lower than the quality of life in the developed countries. We should at least improve our quality of life to the world standard. That means we need to have energy resources, right? In addition to that, since our resources are going down, we need to have an additional source for the long-term energy security. We have renewable energies, we must explore other sources of energies as well. And fusion gives you the most abundant, it is most cleanest source of energy we have, and it is also very abundant in nature. Therefore, we must explore fusion, and that is why we are building a reactor. Now, what is fusion? Fusion is a process in which two nuclei, that is the core of the atoms, combine to form a third nuclei along with the release of large amount of energy. Now, from where the energy comes from? The difference in the mass between the product and the reactants. So in this picture, what you see that two hydrogen nuclei, that is what you call a proton, combine to form a deuterium nuclei, that is a heavy hydrogen, along with some other neutrinos and positrons with the release of large amount of energy. Now, in order to combine two protons, protons are like charges, they would like to repel each other. To combine them, you need to overcome the repulsion between the two. This repulsion between the two, in order to do that, we have to give energy to the particles, to the nuclei. So that is where we have to supply energy. And if this reaction happens anywhere in the nature, we just heard that this is the reaction which gives light in sun. So how sun is formed, how this reaction happens in sun? In the earlier days, when sun was forming, there were a lot of hydrogen gas in the atmosphere, in the universe. This hydrogen gas is compressed by the gravitational force. Now, when you compress a gas, it starts to heat up. As a consequence, the temperature of the gas increased in the core of the sun, which resulted in the formation of a plasma in it. The electrons and ions got separated and formed a plasma in it. Now, the kinetic energy of the energy of the plasma is so high that the protons start to combine to give helium nuclei and also other higher elements. And this released a lot of energy. Now, the energy is formed in the core of the sun, which is eventually get transported to the surface of the sun, and we see it as light in our day-to-day lives. Now, we have to remember two things. The gravity is always trying to push the sun closer to each other. At the same time, there is a huge temperature, high temperature pressure gas inside the sun, the plasma inside the sun. This tries to expand the sun. So eventually they reach an equilibrium, that is between the gravity and the pressure forces. This keeps the sun in its shape. So sun is basically a well-confined system with the help of gravity. Now, if you want to make a fusion reaction on Earth and produce energy from this, what we need to do is we are not gifted by that high gravity as sun has or sun is. So we ask a few questions like, how can we produce fusion on Earth? How to create a fusion relevant plasma in Earth, in the lab? That is the first important question, because the temperature in the core of the sun is several million degrees centigrade. Therefore, how are we going to hold such a plasma? And even if you create, how are you going to sustain such a plasma over a long time? And most importantly, on what type of container would you keep it? Because most of the materials we know will melt. So how are we going to contain such a plasma? And the ultimate question is, how finally are we going to extract energy from this reaction? And in this talk, we will see each of these questions. So, we try to address some of these questions, and the answer to this question or addressing these questions were the fusion research that has been going on for past several decades. So the first question, how are you going to create a fusion relevant plasma? What you see on the left hand side is a picture of the chance or the probability that the fusion reaction can happen as a function of temperature. So what you see is, if you increase the temperature, the probability of the fusion reaction goes up, right? Now, the red curve on the left-hand side shows the fusion reaction probability in sun from hydrogen, a proton. Proton means the simple hydrogen, you ionize it, you get a proton and an electron. Now, if you combine proton, what probability you have for the fusion reaction is shown in the left side, in the red curve. Clearly, if you go to heavier hydrogen, that means hydrogen atoms with protons and neutrons. If you go for DT reaction, that is one hydrogen isotope with one proton and one neutron, one proton with two neutrons. If you combine them, your chance of making fusion reaction goes up. Let us take a number, let us look at the number. Suppose we take a 10 meter by 10 meter by 10 meter box, a rectangular box, in which you keep a hot proton-proton plasma at 10 Kelvin, 10 keV, that means 100 million degrees centigrade. And you take the same plasma of deuterium and tritium, which is the isotope of hydrogen. You see, proton-proton would give you less than one reaction per second. So the energy production yield is very small. The moment you go to deuterium and tritium, you produce 10 to the power 20 reactions per second. That means you put 20 zeros after 10. So the yield is tremendous in the case of deuterium and tritium. Therefore, on Earth, we have no other choice other than for going for DT fusion reaction. So how do you make this reaction? We take a plasma. We make a plasma of deuterium and tritium gas. We heat it up to very high temperature, such that the fusion reactions can take place. Now the temperature is like between 10 keV, 1 eV is the 1 electron volt, is the kinetic energy of the particle, which can be converted to a temperature of 10 to the power 4 Kelvin. That is, 10 keV is like 100 million degrees centigrade. So you would like to keep somewhere between 100 to 200. Now, what is the other advantage of DT fusion? We have no choice, but it is a very good thing. Because the moment you take deuterium and tritium, you can heat up to 10 keV, then you produce a helium isotope, helium atom. They combine to form a helium atom and a neutron. Now, the neutrons have an energy. You heard how fast this neutron moves and what is the energy of this neutron in the previous talk, right? So this energy can be tapped to make electricity, to produce energy, convert to heat and produce electricity. That is what we do in fusion energy production. Now, the advantage of this process is deuterium is abundant in nature. The water contains deuterium. You have heavy water, which is D2O. And tritium is naturally available, but in very small quantities. However, we can make tritium by the process of transmutation, which also you heard in the previous talk. Now, you just look at the numbers. If you want to produce 10 to the power 9 joule of energy, that is 1 gigajoule of energy. Just if you burn 40 kilogram of coal, we don't just burn 40 kilogram, we don't take into account any losses here. This can produce 1 gigajoule of energy. But if you want to produce the same amount of energy from fusion, you need less than 2 milligrams of tritium. So the amount of fuel that you need to produce fusion is significantly low. And coal burning produces CO2. This is not good for atmosphere because it's a greenhouse gas which raises the temperature and we hear of global warming and so on. That's not in the case of tritium because you are not producing any carbon containing gases or any of the greenhouse gases for that matter. Another advantage of fusion over other nuclear methods of energy production is that there are not many long-lived radioisotopes. That means you don't have a long-term radioactivity present in the nature. So if we can make energy from fusion, this is advantageous over many of the existing technologies. And it can also give a long-term energy security. Now the billion-dollar question comes, how are we going to confine the plasma? I told that we don't have the benefit of gravity, but we have the advantage of magnetic field, because plasma is nothing but charged particle. Charged particles can be confined using magnetic field. So we use the method of magnetic confinement, which we will come in the subsequent slides to see how fusion can be produced. And the fusion power density which we aim for or we can produce in tokamaks or in magnetic confinement machines are typically of the order of several megawatts per meter cube, 10 to the power 7 megawatt, which is much larger than the fusion power density that you can get from sun, which is like 300 watt per meter cube. So sun is a larger machine or a larger fusion reactor where you produce, the power density is therefore much smaller. Now we see how the magnetic confinement can magnetic fields can produce confinement. So if you have a magnetic field, the charged particle would feel a force which try to keep, the magnetic field would try to keep the charged particle close to it by bending its trajectories. This is what the famous Lorentz forces. The direction of the force will be the perpendicular to the magnetic field and perpendicular to the motion of the charged particle. So if you look a little video here, we see that there is a charge, the magnetic field lines are in the y direction along the board, and the charged particles move in a spiral path around this particular field line. This particular motion of charged particle in the magnetic field is what you call helical motion. Now you see that the charged particles are not free to move, they are confined around the field line. So their freedom of motion is restricted. Now the question comes, how are you going to produce a magnetic field? The simple answer is you make a current carrying coil. If you have a current carrying coil, the magnetic field would look like this on what you see on the left hand side along the axis of the coil. Now the charged particles, both electrons and ions, would gyrate, would make a helical motion around this magnetic field line. Now owing to the smaller mass of electrons, electrons will be more tightly bound to the field compared to the ions. Ions make larger spirals and electrons make smaller spirals. However, the charged particle which is here can leave the field, can leave the magnetic field line along the axis. So they will lose from the, they get lost from the edges. So how can you prevent the axial losses? One simple way of doing it is instead of having a straight field, uniform field, you just bend the field lines at the edges. So what you see here, the charged particle will spiral around the field, get reflected from the edges. This is a way you can confine the magnetic, in a magnetic field, which is called a mirror because of the reflection. Now the charged particle can escape. If there is very high energetic particle, they can lose the confinement. The another simple way is instead of making a straight solenoid, you bend the solenoid into the form of a torus. So here what you see is these black ones are the solenoid current carrying coils, which is bent in the form of a circle, and you have taken a vessel in which you are creating the plasma. Now the magnetic field in this case is along the axis of the torus. In such a system, the charged particle would move like continuously moving along the magnetic field line, and they are better confined in this case. Now, because we bend a straight field, you have created some asymmetries in the magnetic field distribution. It is no longer symmetric. You have stronger field in the inside and a weaker field at the outside. Therefore, the plasma experiences certain kind of forces, the charged particle experience certain kind of forces, and to prevent that, we make the field line helical so that the charged particle would be much more confined. Now, how to make a helical field line? There are two ways of doing it. One, you twist the field lines by themselves physically, which is what the concept called stellarator, which means you make star inside. That stell comes from the word star. And or you still make a circular solenoid, but additionally you drive a current through the plasma. This is what the concept of tokamak. And this is what we are going to make for creating, or we are going to make an ITER for creating fusion power. Now if you look at the schematic of the tokamak, this is how it look like. What you see here are the circular solenoid, the tan colored things are the circular solenoid. And you pass a current through which create a magnetic field along the axis. Now you pass a current along the axis which create a magnetic field in the opposite direction, in the circular direction, so that the net field is helical in shape. Now the question is how you drive a current by inducing an electric field in the plasma, which is done by the transformer, by discharging through a central transformer or a central solenoid. Now the plasma, the magnetic forces keeps the plasma in equilibrium so that plasma will try to expand, but however you apply magnetic field through using different coils like which is running around the torus, and this keeps the plasma in stable condition. So let's see how this whole process happens. You have a hot gas, you try to heat it to very high temperature, so it becomes ions and electrons, becomes a plasma. This is then in a magnetic field line, they are circling around, and if you bend the field line, now the field line is straight, so they are going in the direction. Now the moment you bend the field line, it moves around the torus. This is how we confine the plasma. Now, one of the interesting point is plasma would not like to stay where it is. The confinement of the plasma is even further interesting because charged particles would like to move from its position because of the forces acting on it. Now, the collisions between charged particles is one of the way the charged particles get lost, and this way the charged particles are coming out of its position when moving towards the walls. In the picture lower, where you see, now that you bent the magnetic field line, you see that there is a stronger field inside and a weaker field outside. Inside here, you have very strong magnetic field. Outside, you have weaker field. So the charged particle would do the same thing as the mirror did. From the weaker field to stronger field, it will reflect back, again go back and forth. This kind of confinement has made a historic stride. And what we see right now is this was one of the major challenge in the tokamak confinement. So what you see on the left-hand side is the earliest tokamak, which was made in 1958 by Russians, which is why we have the name tokamak, which means toroidal magnetic chamber, confinement chamber. And this has the same shape as a circular, and you see the coils here, which are running around this thing, and the toroidal solenoid is what you see here. Now, these machines could conclusively show that plasma could be stable, and you can confine plasma. However, the plasma energy was lost. The plasma, there are a series of machines which happened between 1959 and 70. These machines have shown that you can heat the plasmas to very high temperature. And in fact, this was the time people conclusively made the conclusively proof that tokamak could be the reactor designed for the future machines. And one of the historic event in the tokamak history was the measurement of temperature. Because people, now you have to measure temperatures of the order of several million degrees centigrade. So how you measure it? There were spectroscopic techniques people have used to measure by looking at the light from the different lights from the tokamak, from the plasma. And this was an important event because that also showed this particular tokamak T3, which was a Russian machine, has shown that plasma can be heated up to a million degrees centigrade. Before that, we did not have any conclusive measurement. Now, we know now from then onwards that the plasma temperature can be even higher. Now, we heard in the previous talk that plasma is a good conductor of electricity. We already heard several times. And you heard a thing that plasma can be heated by passing a current through it, right? But it is a peculiar conductor. Unlike normal, in the case of copper, if you heat further, like if you heat the copper conductor along, then the current carrying capacity goes down because the resistance increases, the heat increases. Copper is, plasma is behaves in opposite way. As you heat the plasma, the temperature goes down. Because of that, we have to have special ways of heating plasma, which is what you do more like what we do in a microwave, where you launch a wave in the microwave frequency, which is resonates with the molecule vibration of the water molecule, so that you can effectively impart the energy to the water. Similarly, here we do the same thing. We launch waves of different frequencies, now not in the water molecule frequency, but the plasma oscillation frequencies, which we saw that plasma moves in circles around the field line. So we launch waves in the electron frequency and the ion frequency to heat the plasma. Over the time, tokamaks continued to evolve. So starting from the Russian machine, we have several machines came up. These machines have shown better ways of producing magnetic field. Here we speak of magnetic fields of the order of several Teslas. That means you need to pass really very high current through the coils, like several mega ampere of current you have to pass through these coils which is around them, which has driven the idea of superconducting coils. The ways of heating plasma has also improved. People could show that the temperature can be reached up to 8 to 9, 10 kV. And these machines were all over the world. And what you see on the left-hand side is our own machine in India, which is called steady-state superconducting tokamak, which is using superconducting coils to produce high magnetic field. And right now, it's in the reboot phase. Now, if you look at the overall history of tokamak, there was one more important point, that is, we could demonstrate fusion can happen. So deuterium, tritium, plasma were taken in one of the machine called Joint European Torus in 1980s. And similarly, another machine in the US, TFTR, they have shown that you can produce power from, you can produce fusion power. Of course, the power produced was very low, like 10 megawatt and 20 megawatt, etc. And one more important point is that these machines, the fusion power produced was much smaller than the energy that you coupled to the plasma using different heating mechanisms. So this was just a demonstration of fusion. And in ITER, what we are going to show is we can produce absolutely more fusion power than the energy that you coupled to the plasma. That is more than 10 times. So the Q here, people typically call this as Q, the energy gain, that is the output fusion energy upon the energy input, is roughly 10 or more is ITER going to demonstrate. So if we sum it up all the history and the evolution of tokamak, which is the tokamak evolution of tokamak physics, what you see here in this simple plot is on the x-axis you have the ion temperature. That is the temperature of the ions in the plasma, which is important for fusion, which is shown in kilo electron volt. And on the y-axis, what you call is a figure of merit, but is called fusion triple product, which is nothing but the product of density, temperature, and the confinement time of the plasma. So if you increase the density, temperature, and the confinement time, you can increase the fusion power. Now if you look at the band, you see that on the other side of the y-axis, you see the time of evolution. So this is the point where you have a self-heated plasma. That means you have very high power, fusion power, compared to the amount of energy that you put in. That is what you see here, reactor condition in the upper belt. And you see that ITER is very close to it. So we are in a regime where we can produce plasmas, which is what burning plasmas, that means self-heated plasmas, which is important for making fusion power reactors. You also see that in these machines, the one thing about the data of this machine, these machines show different temperature, density, different evolution of the first machine, T3, where you measured 1 keV temperature was the historic event, till all the fusion machine, like here you see the gain of jet, here TFTR, the first machines where DT fission was demonstrated. So if we think from the historic viewpoint, it all started as a classified work for military purposes. It was Bhava, the Indian scientist who was instrumental in Indian nuclear program, who said in the Geneva Convention 1955 that fusion could be used for peaceful purposes. And 2 years later, there came up a number of papers, more than 105 papers were published in fusion research, which became declassified, and the temperature measurement was the first important event where a basis of a solid international collaboration in fusion has started. And now we are at ITER, which is a collaborative project among different countries in the world to demonstrate the scientific and technological feasibility of fusion energy for peaceful purposes. So what you see on the left-hand side is a picture from 2005. Where the negotiations for where to build ITER, the site, ITER site, has started. And in 2006, an agreement has been signed between seven different nations for the shared construction and partnership in ITER project, the International Thermonuclear Experiment, where European Union contribute 5/11 of the whole project, and all other partners like China, India, Korea, Japan would contribute 1/11. Now, what does that mean? We are contributing 1/11 of the project in terms of the share, in terms of the construction, shared construction, and we get the technology of the 100%. That is what the project is about. Now, if you look at the parameters of ITER, this is the machine which you will see a better view of this machine in upstairs. So this is the tan colored coils are the toroidal field coils, which is producing an enormous amount of magnetic field of 5.3 Tesla along the torus, along the axis. So these coils carry a current of roughly 170 mega amps. There are 18 such coils built together. And the radius of the machine, which you measure from the axis to the center of this plasma, is roughly 6.2 meter. And the height of the plasma inside this would be roughly 2 meter. So it amounts to roughly 1,000 meter cube plasma volume. And you drive a current of 15 megaamps along the axis of the machine. We plan to put up to 73 megawatt of heating power, which is the power that is coupled to plasma in different forms, like wave heating, particle heating, etc. And we get a net power of 500 megawatt. Temperature is between 10 to 20 kV. Now, how confident are we about our measurements? That is what this plot shows. This is an interesting plot where what you see on the x-axis is how long can you confine the plasma in a magnetic field. So this is called the plasma confinement, energy confinement time. How long can you confine the plasma energy using the magnetic field? And on the y-axis, this is the theoretical calculation. And on the y-axis, what you see, theoretical scaling law. On the y-axis, what you see is the observations from different machines around the world. Now, these machines were of different, they were of different radius to major radius to minor radius ratios, of different magnetic field, different sizes, and also different temperature. If you look at together, we see that ITER is on the top, which would mean that our scaling is very robust, and our predictions for ITER, for future reactor, shows it is absolutely higher than any of the existing machines. Now, what is the goal of ITER? The goal of ITER is to demonstrate 500, the most important goal is to demonstrate 500 megawatt fusion power for about 400 seconds with an energy gain of 10 or more than 10. So this is the absolutely highest power so far we can think of. And second important aspect is it is using self-heated or burning plasmas, which is used by alpha particles. So what happens is that the fusion reaction produces alpha particles and neutrons. The alpha particles would be used to heat the plasma back. So this is what the self-heating. And we can even reduce the input power further by using the alpha power. And the neutrons that is produced in the reactor would be used to make tritium back by having a reaction with lithium. So it will show alpha heated plasmas as well as in-vessel tritium breeding. This process of making tritium within the vessel, within the fusion reactor, is called breeding, and ITER will demonstrate this. Then ITER has variety of technologies from heat. We will see them in detail, like heating for cooling, temperature, cryostat, etc. We will see those integration of technologies together in a large scale for the first time. And it is also aimed to make a controlled plasma operation by taking into account the safety considerations of nuclear safety considerations. And these are the goals of ITER. Now, what are the components of ITER? So the ITER components are basically, this is a model of this machine you will see in the third floor of the exhibition, where this is, what you see here is the vessel. This is the vessel in which you are taking, this is a stainless steel vessel in which you are making the plasma. And plasma, this vessel has two walls, it's a double walled vessel, inside which you fill materials which can shield the neutrons such that the toroidal field coils, which is just next to it in the blue color, toroidal field coils are not hit by the neutrons. Now, we have to keep the coils at a very low temperature because they are superconducting. So there will be technologies for showing the, for cooling the coils. Then another important component of ITER is the central solenoid through which you drive a current to generate the plasma and also heat the plasma in the initial stage. So if you look at the central solenoid, for example, this is manufactured by USA, and you can see the size. This is one sector of the central solenoid, and you can see the size ratio, how big the central solenoid is. Similarly, if you look at the TF coils, which is a toroidal field coils, this is one coil which is supposed to carry roughly 9 megaamps of current, and this is, you can see the ratio, so many people can stand inside, right? And this is a coil made by Japan. And then one thing is the plasma inside is very hot, like a million degrees centigrade. So we have to, which amounts to a high heat load of several megawatt per square meter, which we have to effectively channel. And for that, we use components of that can handle extremely high heat flux, which is called diverter. So this is another important aspect of ITER. Then there is a blanket, which is used to shield, which will be used to shield the neutrons from the vacuum vessel. And this is also made of tiny little blocks which are welded together. So there involves a lot of technology in making these components. And another major contribution is the cryostat, because cryostat is a vacuum flask in which the whole ITER is kept, which prevents the thermal leakage between of the 4 Kelvin cool liquid helium components to outside. And there will be a thermal shield. Then there are components like feeders through which the liquid helium and the liquid helium along with the current will be supplied to the toroidal field coil. Now we will see more details of this in the next. Now I have started with the ITER site, but if you look at the ITER site, this is how it looked like. Here is the machine will be, the ITER machine, which is a 30 meter long cryost machine, which will be housed in a 60 meter deep pit. And this is the assembly hall where the components of ITER will be assembled. On the back, you see the various workshops like PF coil, where the ploidal field coils are made, then cryo plant, which produces the liquid helium for cooling of the different components. Then this is the power station, which powers ITER. And there is a tritium building, which you see here, where the tritium reprocessing will be taking place. The fuel which you put in, you want to reprocess it. So that's how the site will be. And this is the place, this is a pit in which the whole cryostat will be kept. And this is the top view of that. Now we go on to what different parties contribute. So we have seen that different components of ITER is contributed by different parties. And what India's contribution to ITER project is what we are going to see. So India's contribution to ITER project is carried out by Indian domestic agency, which is in Institute for Plasma Research, which is a project in IPR under Department of Atomic Energy. And what you see here is the lab in of ITER India in the building in IPR. So you see background IPR labs. And in this is located in Ahmedabad. And here we test the components that we have to deliver to ITER. So what are the components? India contributes to total 9% of the total ITER. That's 1/11th of total ITER contribution, which involves cooling technologies, high power engineering like heating, beam technologies, also plasma diagnostics, which is used to measure plasma parameters. So we will see in short what are the first component I would say is cryostat, which provides vacuum insulation for the magnet. So it is basically a stainless steel vessel of 30 meter height and 30 meter dia, which is made up of stainless steel of 80 mm thick. So this, you can imagine, this is like a 10 story building, which is the height of the cryostat, which is made up of 4 different parts. And this is made by a company, L&T, in Hazira in Gujarat. And this is, the components are made parts by parts, and finally they are shipped to ITER and assembled there. We will see a small video of how this is done. The cryostat finally will be assembled. So what you see is the cryostat base. Here we lower this particular component. This was already handed over to ITER in 23rd July this year. And this is the lower cylinder of the cryostat, which has the ports which are required for installing the diagnostics to access the plasma. This is the upper cylinder of the cryostat. And finally, we install everything in the cryostat and put the top lid. Now, this is how it would look like. Another important aspect of the ITER Indian contribution to ITER is the shielding, neutron shielding of the components. So, especially the magnet. So, ITER vacuum vessel in which we make the plasma is double walled. In between, we put special steel, borated steel, to prevent the neutrons and also some other special steel for correcting the magnetic field at the edges. So this is how it looked like. It may be better if we look at the video, then you will see clearly. So there is, this is the magnet system. You remove the magnet system, then you start to see the vacuum vessel of ITER. If you remove the outer cover of the vacuum vessel, you start to see these structures, which are the involved shields made of special borated steel. There are 9 such sectors, and roughly all each sector consists of thousands or 9,000 blocks we make, each of them. And these blocks are made separately. Then the parts of the cryostat will have to be welded. So this is the detailed structure. And each of the structure, if you zoom in, you see that there are little plates with, and the interesting shapes here you see is because of the housing, that bolt you have to connect. So the housing of that cryostat is what you see. Now comes housing of the vacuum vessel. Now comes the cryo distribution, which is basically you need to cool the magnet. So ITER magnets will be cooled at 4 Kelvin. And they are surrounded by a large cryostat, which is again actively cooled by 80 Kelvin hydrogen gas. So what you see here is a picture of the cryo line, which will be, here is your cryo plant building in ITER site, which we see. Then the cryogens, that is liquid helium and gaseous helium, low pressure gaseous helium, low temperature, high pressure gaseous helium, will be taken to the machine with using cryo lines. And this is a section of a cryo line, which is a pipe through which is a specially designed pipe with different successive thermal shields, is what you see here. So this involves, you have to take the cryo lines from the cryo plant. So cryogens have to be transported from the cryo plant to the tokamak building, and there are some cold boxes are needed, because this acts as a buffer between the fluctuating load of the tokamak and the constant supply of cryogens from the cryo plant. So these cryo boxes are made by India, and the whole cryo assembly, that is starting from the cryo plant to the machine. So what you see here is a cryo termination cold box. So there are 3 cold boxes, which is supplying liquid helium, will be sent through this buffer box. And eventually, this is taken through the cryo lines to the tokamak building. And this, note the special structure it has, because it has a bent structure. So when you deliver this thing, one has to test the whole component in the desired shape. And another important aspect is the heating systems of tokamak. As I told, we have microwave, the heating system, again I recap that this is more like wave heating, like happens in microwave. So what happened is that you launch a wave, which is at a high frequency in the megahertz range, to the plasma, which will resonate with the ion cyclotron frequency of the plasma. So that is how you are going to heat, which the heating power required is roughly 20 megawatt, and at 53 megahertz, that is the ion cyclotron frequency. There are 8 such sources will be delivered to ITER, and each of them is going to produce 2 to 3 megawatt per source. Similarly, we have heating methods for heating electrons, where you deliver 2 sources, each of them have a power of 1 megawatt each, with a frequency, which is now, it's much higher because it's the electron cyclotron frequency, of 170 gigahertz. And if you look at the total heating and system, we always will have to connect to tokamak building, and here we see the heating end. So these are the 8 RF sources, radio frequency ion cyclotron heating sources of 3 megawatt each will be supplied from India. And these are the high frequency 170 megahertz electron, 2 sources, 1 megawatt each will be supplied by India. There are, of course, other ECRH sources from other parties. And the cooling water for this, the heat removal, is also given by, is shown here. Now comes to the power supplies which are needed for these systems. So the ITER power supplies are of three types. Basically, they are needed for heating, the ion cyclotron heating, electron cyclotron heating, and also for the neutral beam system, which we will come to in a short while. So the power supplies are basically of three type. They are, some are very high voltage power supply, some are high current power supply. So if you look here, what you see here is a high voltage transmission line for connecting the power supplies to system has been tested in ITER India. And you can see some of the grid power supplies here. And this is how the power supplies will be used. So these are the buildings which will be involved. This is the one which we saw, the heating power supply connected to this ICRH heating systems. Then there will be power supplies for the ECRH systems here. And these are the power supplies for the diagnostics, which we will come in a minute. So do you see the hall transmission line and the high voltage deck? And this is the tokamak building you can see here. Finally, those systems are integrated to the, for example, the transmission lines, which will be coming here. We will see that in a minute. Now comes the diagnostic neutral beam, which is another, which is basically we measure the helium produced, the fusion, how much helium has been produced in the fusion reaction is measured using diagnostic neutral beam, which consists of an ion source which produces negative ions, which is accelerated to very high 100 kV voltage. Then it is passed through a gas which will strip the excess electron to make a neutral beam. And finally, this neutral beam is launched to the plasma. This neutral beam interacts with the helium ion, helium 2 plus ion, via a process called charge exchange. So they just change their charges. And this process creates an excited helium which emits 468 nanometer line. Now this radiation is what we are going to detect using another diagnostic. So the whole package is to make the diagnostic neutral beam. It is a negative ion based source with 100 kV beam energy and 20 kiloamps beam current. Now what you see here is a section of the beam. So you see that there is a high voltage component involved here, the picture is. Then there is an ion source which is passing through a neutralizer and eventually through different successive thing. And as a part of the diagnostic neutral beam, there are test facilities being developed in ITER India. This is an Indian test facility which is an 8 RF source which makes the neutral beam, which is the plasma source from which you extract the neutral beam. Now, if you look at the neutral beam components, I think this doesn't work. So basically, okay, it does work. So what you see here is the diagnostic neutral beam. This is how it is connected to the tokamak. That is the view. And you start to see that this is the high voltage part where you need to produce 100 kV beam. And this is the ion source, which is the 8 RF driver source, which is connected to the neutralizer where the neutralization happens and produces H hydrogen neutral, and which is passed through a residual ion dump in case if there are some ions are also extracted. Finally, it is connected to the machine with the machine components. That's how the diagnostic neutral beam line would be. And it has a 20 meter beam line, which will Now comes the diagnostics part. In addition to, so we produce a helium helium charge exchange line using the neutral beams. Now, this we will measure using charge exchange recombination spectroscopy, which is basically we detect this line. We also measure, we have diagnostics to measure the plasma temperature, which is called electron cyclotron emission. So we can imagine that at this temperature, electron cyclotron emission is purely depending on the temperature of the plasma. Then there are ways to detect impurities in the plasma, which is called, you detect the X-ray line emitted by the impurities from the plasma. And these are the packages of the diagnostic along with an upper port where you install some of the diagnostics. Now, these are the components of the diagnostics. So you see that there is a long transmission line for electron cyclotron emission and various, this is how they are connected to the, on the right hand side, you will see how it is connected to the torus and so on. Now we can see a quick view of how this is done. Maybe in this case the video actually doesn't work. Sorry. No, yeah, it does. We have to wait. That's so this is the transmission line that you see, the electron cyclotron emission. So you look at the cyclotron emission from the plasma, which is in gigahertz range. And this is the upper port which we will give to the ITER. So the port has a port plug and the housing for the diagnostics and so on. And this is the whole transmission line for diagnostics, ECE, electron cyclotron emission diagnostics. And there will be a diagnostic room, there is a diagnostic building to which it is connected. So that is the package of ITER India. Now, there is one remaining question, how are we going to put together these pieces? So ITER is the world's largest puzzle, where you get components from different people, assemblies, parts of machine from different people, and how are they going to put together? So this is a video which shows. These are different parts of the, this is a TF coil, the toroidal field coil, which will be made, which is supposed to carry 9 megamps of current per coil. These are the involved shield, the components which we saw. We are making the shielding components. This is the cryostat. Then we lower the upper cylinder of the cryostat. That's how the machine would look like. You can see the size of the person in comparison with the machine size. And the way they are handled, so it's, the whole cryostat weighs roughly 4,000 tons. So, and these are different parts of the cylinders that you raise. That is the base section which will be put, where you put the central solenoid eventually. So now, different parts of the components are made by different people. Even the same component like TF coil, for example, has made by different people, different parties. So the important challenge here is to match the quality standards and the ITER quality standards for these components and to build them in the way Yeah, now the central solenoid and the connections are given to its support structures, you see. This is a simulated video. Of course, we are not there right now. We are start to only, you'll see that in a short while. So, in conclusion, what are we going to say? In the quest for fusion energy, ITER has indeed made a tremendous progress, ITER collaboration. And 60% of the project, physical progress of the project has been made. And India is contributing roughly 1/11th of the total project, and India's activities of manufacturing and shipping are in full swing. In this process, the greatest lesson we learned was Indian industries are getting technologies, because most of these components are made by, almost all the components are made by Indian industries, like cryostat, vacuum vessel component, etc. So they are getting exposed to new technologies, high voltage technology, high power RF technologies, and so on, which requires materials of new kind, challenging kind. These are also being developed by Indian industries. In addition to that, Indian ITER project has started a nationwide collaboration for among students, among universities, for research projects that are relevant to fusion. So that is where we stand right now. And the next step of ITER would be to demonstrate, next step beyond ITER would be to demonstrate fusion power, electricity generation from fusion power. That is what demo power plants are planning to do. Having said that, ITER is our hope for energy of freedom of the world at large, for the development of large part of humanity that is presently underdeveloped. ITER is the way to the new paradigm that the world would desperately looking for. This has been told by Dr. Anil Kakodkar, former AEC chairman, on 23rd July 2009, where India has formally handed over the base section of the cryostat in ITER organization. So, thank you. Finally, in France, it will be installed in France. So, the ITER construction is supposed to be finished by 2024, and the first plasma is expected in 2025. We are able to sustain up to the, we are able to sustain very long pulse plasmas. However, ITER is aiming at 400 seconds. So that means the energy confinement time. The plasma duration will be longer, but how long can you keep the energy? So that is like 4 seconds in ITER, and the total plasma duration is expected to be 400 seconds. So
this is an experimental project in the sense that we are very far from actually using it for commercial use, right?
So the aim of ITER is to produce fusion energy, which is 10 times more than the energy that you couple to plasma. Now, we are not producing electricity from this, but we are demonstrating all the technologies that needed to run the reactor. For example, breeding, self-heating of plasmas. So all the and also we are doing heat extraction from the plasma, from ITER. But we are not producing electricity from there. That is a step we are not doing here. Yeah. But all other technologies that is relevant for demo will be, a demonstration reactor will be done in ITER.
So do we know how far we are from actually being able to generate electricity, or is it something that can't really be predicted? It's all dependent on the research.
So the demo construction or demo plant, the basic ideas are already in the already developing, and the construction or the plant realization is maybe around 2035 is what people say.
Okay.